I want to really look at some of the challenges that climate change poses to the historic environment, but I also want to look at some of the positive actions and the positive steps that, you know, the sector itself is taking in this emergency. And hopefully, I'm hoping it will provide some context as to why climate is one of the five critical missions that's been outlined in the action plan and the overriding plan of the park. So to start really, I think it's still important to start with some of the science and some of the data behind all of this. You can see this, I think it's quite a visual and very stark graphic that shows temperature change in Wales since 1884. Red, darker, means warmer than the blue. And I think it's pretty obvious where the trend is going on this. We live on a warming planet. And the reasons behind that is our activities, our day-to-day living, and particularly that since the Industrial Revolution. Basically, our emissions, the carbon dioxide that we're putting into the atmosphere is having a terrible effect to our planet. There's 40% more carbon dioxide in the atmosphere today since the Industrial Revolution. And just from 2010 to 2019, the average temperature is now nearly 1 degree warmer than it was in 1970 to 2010. And I'm sure you'll be hearing in the news that this year is again one of the warmer, and we're tipping towards that horrible 1.5 degrees, which is not where we want to be. So what does that mean? Well, a warming planet brings about very different changes in weather. And there's four headline changes that we're seeing in our weather patterns. And that's warmer mean temperatures. We're looking at hotter, drier summers. We're looking at warmer, wetter winters. And we're looking at more frequent extreme weather. And I think every one of you sat here now will probably sit and think back about the weather patterns in the last year or two. And you can probably relate to every single one of these things that we're talking about, whether it be flooding, whether it be the drought conditions that we're experiencing, or all the named storms that we seem to have barreling our way towards us. Sea level rise is another impact of this. And, you know, we're looking at sort of 1.2 to 1.6 millimetre rise in sea levels ever since 1901. And that's continuing to rise. And that's going to have a major impact on coastal communities as well. So in terms of the historic environment, what does that mean? I'm going to stray outside of the park on some of these just to give a broader look around the historic environment. So obviously coastlines is going to be a big issue with rising sea levels. And our rich coast, the sort of Pembroke Coast National Park, for example, other areas have these wonderful monuments in it. One such as these up in Gwynedd, this is Dinas Dinllaw Hill Fort. In Gwynedd, we've done a lot of work here recently. We've lost 50 metres of this monument since about 1900. And we've done a lot of calculations and projections. And for a monument that's been in the landscape there for 2,500 years, we think we've probably got about 300 more years for this monument. Rising sea levels, increased water, which is pushing away the cliff face, is destroying this. And we have to learn to understand that we will be losing parts of our historic environment. We will be losing those sites and places that mean so much to us. Perhaps a bit closer to home, let's look at some of the other aspects. This was the Monmouthshire and Brecon Canal, internationally significant monument. So 2013, 2014, increased rainfall led to slippage on this canal. It led to slippage, it led to cracking that ended up resulting in the whole canal having to be drained. Everything was closed and major repair works were needed on this site. Most of you might recognise that this is from the air. This is Crookowl. Unfortunately, many of you might also live here and have experienced some really terrible things that happened here as a result of flooding. obviously it goes without saying that the impact of this to people, to personal lives, to well-being, to livelihood is at the top of the tree. But the impacts also ricochet down much, much further than that. So, for example, in terms of the historic environment in our buildings, we see the suffering of damages to things such as the bridges there that need continual repair. We see flooding that impacts some of the earthworks and the archaeology. These are sites that aren't destined to be submerged in water all of the time, and it's clear impacts that we see from that. But it's not just individual sites and places, it's whole landscapes. And all the speakers this morning spoke about that our landscapes, our environment, they're all there as and showcase the impact that us as humans have had on them for many, many, many thousands of years. Now, this is one of my favourite places in the national park. If you ever see me out and about, I'm usually running, and this is one of my favourite places to go for a run. I just love this view, as to me, the character that it showcases of the character of a historic environment. You come down off of the tops of the mountains, surrounded by prehistoric tombs and burial monuments, into this landscape of farmlands from the sort of medieval period onwards. And it has a real character to it. And we're going to have to start adapting and seeing what change is going to have in landscape character. We have issues such as invasive species and vegetation, which may change the character of areas that we're looking at. We also have wider impacts. I came running over here in the summer, and you can just see on the slides wildfires, that the impact that the wildfires have had in this region alone. That's destroying archaeology above ground, but also the archaeology below the ground. And if you think about things like peats and peat deposits and the treasure trove of information that they hold in terms of artifacts, ecofacts about past environments, that is a really, you know, significant destruction that's taking place. Other more sort of indirect impacts, this Gangok here, the wonderful, wonderful hill forts on Gangok. This aerial, which was taken a number of years ago, is at the end of the season, this kind of time of year. But what we're seeing is longer growing seasons, warmer climate means that the vegetation is spreading and growing more. So we end up suffering with this vegetation growth that's obscuring our archaeology, our sites and monuments, and in many ways can cause extra destruction. I should never have visited in the summer. I should know better than to attempt to visit lots of hill forts in summers, but that was us wrangling around trying to find the archaeology that was there. And also other indirect impacts, you know, better weather, better summer weather does mean more people want to be out and about and visiting sites, visiting these landscapes. And that's, on one hand, is wonderful, but it also brings with it other challenges that we've all seen today in managing tourism and, for example, visitors to National Park. It means looking after, you know, repairing our pathways. Some of these pathways go across some, you know, important monuments and sites, and that needs to be taken into consideration in relation to erosion. I was up there yesterday, and it was just me and some sheep, and it was perfect. So that's obviously the time to visit. So whilst there's obviously wholeheartedly a lot more negative impacts than there are positive impacts, there are some benefits, some more positive benefits. And one of this, in terms of for archaeology, is new archaeology that comes to light. So warmer weather means increased crop marks, which means if you've got an aerial reconnaissance program such as like that of the Royal Commission, it offers us an opportunity to enhance our records more and discover new archaeology. So new archaeology about sites that we know a lot about, such as this at Penygar Fort, which had excavations in 2011. And this was our standard kind of view of the fort. If we go to 2018, when Toby Driver from the Commission was flying over it, it was like an X-ray appeared as all the crop marks and the features were coming out of the ground. So we had more detail showing all the barrack buildings within the hill fort. We had new information about a new annex that was at the hill fort. We had additional information about the Vikas settlement outside the fort. And we had new knowledge about a new courtyard complex there as well, enabling us to learn more about the archaeology of the fort. But why is the historic environment important in this? Well, you know, we've seen thousands of years of history, and we've seen all of the the information there. And we've also spoken today about how our historic environment, the sites and features, are irreplaceable. They're an irreplaceable resource. The information, the finds, the ecofacts tell us so much about us, past societies. And we risk losing so much of that. And it's also our own personal connections with the past. People, you know, we have places that mean something to us in the landscape. And that's the way of, you know, we risk losing that, not having something to pass on to future generations. But I think it's also bigger than that. It's about the part that the discipline, us as archaeologists, can also play in the climate debate. We're a discipline that can provide the long-term context. There's not many disciplines that can do that. So we can provide the long-term context. Now, climate has changed and people have adapted to climate change for millennia. And that's what we can do to showcase this. Obviously, the reasons behind that are very different today than they were many, many thousands of years ago. But what we can bring to the table is to talk about the resilience of past societies and what people have done to adapt to that. And I think that's a really, really important starting point in the conversations, those difficult conversations that we need to have going forward in relation to climate change. And this is just one example of this. This is back north again, up at Dinas Dinclay, with the work that's been going on there. The coastal zone is dynamic and always has been dynamic, and it's really important to showcase those kind of stories. We know here that in the Mesolithic period, this wasn't a coastal landscape. This was inland. We've got dated evidence from peat deposits that around that point, this was a terrestrial, a freshwater environment. We know by the Iron Age and the Roman period that this was a coastal landscape. We know at that point there was a totally different shoreline. The hill fort that we see today had a harbour attached to it. Water was around it. We know that there were islands in the landscape near where the airport is today. We also know from archaeology and from the work that in the early medieval and the medieval period, it was a really stormy period. These sites that were covered in sand, some people adapted and continued living there, others left the area, they moved away, they couldn't continue living in an area which had such stormy weather and sand inundation. And then we also see from historic records, we see the reclamation of these areas, the seawalls that were being built as people reclaimed the land. And right up to the present day, through our dating and from our work, we can monitor erosion that's happening on one side to our monuments. But we can also showcase the change and the growth in the landscape of the spit that is growing and has been growing since around the time of the hill fort there. So it's building up a picture of real landscape change that we can showcase and bring to the table. So moving forward now, what can we do? For those of us living in the area, living in Wales, living across the planet, there's two ways really. The action plan talks about the way that we're going to mitigate and adapt to climate change, and they're two very, very different things really. So mitigation, that's net zero. It's what we're all doing now, which organisations are doing now. It's what we can do to lessen the impact of climate change. It's the way we live our lives, the way we travel. It might be the things that we eat. It's all of those things that are going to hopefully hopefully improve things slightly with our aim of going down. The other side is to do with adaptation, and that's understanding that the climate is changing, the impact it's happening, and how we live with that and what we do to live with that. And so the heritage sector, since about 2010 and 11, have been working on this. So there's a lot of work being done as a partnership across the whole sector. We have something called the Climate Change, the Historic Environment Climate Change Group. Major organisations, including the National Parks, the Archaeological Trusts, CADU and the Commission, have been working together to look at ways that the historic environment can adapt to climate change. And in 2020, We launched the Sector Adaptation Plan, which has a number of headline actions based around increasing our knowledge. You know, what is there in the historic environment? What do we need to be aware of? Increasing our capacity to deal with climate change, and that could be in showcasing best practice, guidance, and documents. but also building resilience. And that might be in very much proactive work that, we're undertaking. So I wanted to just showcase a few examples of that now. One of the biggest challenges to the historic environment is its building stock. Wales has some of the oldest building stock in Europe. That's part of the factor of it being an industrial nation. So these like 18th and 19th century buildings. These buildings need to adapt, but it's really difficult to take an old building and try and future-proof it. And there's so many bad things that can be done in terms of maladaptation to buildings. So which is why the sector has been working in organisations such as CADU and others have started releasing policy and guidance towards those of us or those people living in older buildings, also about flood resilience, what we can do as individuals. Sometimes we have to accept the inevitable that we are going to be losing sites, but we don't want to just watch them go. We want to make sure we're doing something in advance of that. So schemes and programs, it could be survey, it could be excavation, such as here. This is down in the Pembrokeshire Coast Park, all of the work that's been undertaken by the CADU, the Dyfed Trust and Pembrokeshire Coast National Park in a whole series of excavations over a number of years, accepting the knowledge that this monument will be going. It's about sharing practice about the different techniques and methods that we can do to record our historic environment and the way that we look at it. So there's new guidance that's come out in that relationship. But it's also working together, you know, as a sector. We're not just going to sort of go forward. It's about working with other areas and other sectors. And some of this can be shown in terms of the peatlands and the peatland action plan. Peatlands are so important across so many areas, including for carbon sinks, including for biodiversity, but also they hold a wealth of information for the historic environment, both about people that use them, but also about past environments and climates. So it's really important, and it's seen here in the National Park with the Peatlands Action Plan, about working together all areas of the park, all areas to make sure that every side gets the best out of any sort of preservation and work that happens. It could be from excavation, but it's preserving that information and data for future generations. But it's also the way that we look and the way that we manage the landscape going forward, and that is really going to need to change. And we can do that in so many ways. It could be through the use of volunteers, it could be through management practices. And just here's some of the examples of the work that's already going on in the National Park. I mentioned all about the vegetation on Gangok, but there is a lovely grazing management plan that's coming into place. It's about using volunteers and people to help look after sites. And it's like newer ways to improve things there as well. So that was a really whirlwind tour, I'm afraid, but hopefully just to set the scene to some of the challenges that we have ahead of us, and just to say that there's so much knowledge out there, and knowledge is being built all of the time. We have adaptation case study resources that are out there, and we're starting work now towards a new stage, the National Resilience Plan within Welsh Government, but also a new iteration of the Sector Adaptation Plan for the whole of the environment. And again, that's where the partnership is coming into play. Everyone has a chance to feed into that plan, and everyone then has the opportunity to help the historic environment deliver that plan as well. So thank you very much.